This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. I'm joined by Joshua Foer, who has got a very interesting book out, which, gosh, did I forget the title already? No, I didn't. But this could be the most memorable interview. Say the title of your book.
It's Moonwalking with Einstein.
Moonwalking with Einstein. He comes up with a very interesting way to remember things, and he's actually become the U.S. national champion in 2006 of
yeah,
the memory.
Yeah, a few years back.
Because now you've probably forgotten that already. But let's talk about, first of all, what is this competition? You kind of wrote this book partly out of an assignment, but also this fascinating little world of people who try to memorize.
Oh, it's totally strange. I mean, there is this contest that's held every spring in New York City called the U.S. Memory Championship. And I had gone to cover it as a science journalist, figuring that it was going to be like savants, people with photographic memory, freaks of nature of some kind. Turned out the people who entered this contest, who competed, who were able to memorize entire poems, decks of playing cards, random numbers, the names of hundreds of strangers, they all claimed they had average memories and that they had trained themselves to do this.
Anybody who can memorize a deck of cards, we think, must be a genius.
Must be a savant or something, right? No, it's actually, there are ancient techniques that these people are using to do this. And I got so intrigued with this, I was like, you got to teach me. And I ended up spending basically the better part of the next year training my memory, but also trying to understand how it works and why it sometimes doesn't work and what its potential might be. And then I came back to that same contest a year later and entered it as like an experiment in participatory journalism.
Right. So. And you won.
And I won, which definitely was not supposed to happen.
So what's been, you know, happening and is fascinating to a lot of people in a weird way is that our memories, my memory specifically, is really becoming something that's kept out of my brain more.
Sure.
It's in my BlackBerry. It's on, frankly, Google Maps and search and everything else. But is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Well, it's probably like everything with technology. It's both. It's definitely changed us. It's changed how we think about our memories, how we use our memories. But this is an old story. 2,500 years ago, Socrates was up in arms about this new invention called writing. And he said, once people start taking their memories out of their minds, putting them down on papyrus, people are going to become forgetful. The culture is headed down this terrible, treacherous slope. And we might say that he was overstating the case from our position today, but there's something in what he was saying that rings kind of true. That there's a way in which, if you're going to have new ideas, have new thoughts, link to things that don't previously go together, that requires having stuff knocking around in your skull. Your BlackBerry never invented a new idea.
And you talk a little bit about these memory palaces. What are those?
Okay, so memory palaces, this is a technique, a memory technique that was invented in ancient Greece in the 5th century BC. Once widely known, widely practiced, I had never heard of it before, which tells you something, just how much things have changed. And the basic idea is, if you can use your incredible spatial memory, because we all have pretty good spatial memories, to remember information that might otherwise be hard to remember, it becomes stickier.
And we're talking about memorizing what? Poetry, numbers?
Poetry, random numbers. One event, they have 5 strangers get up on stage and just reel off all of this biographical information. Name, favorite foods, address, phone number, what kind of car they drive. And you have to remember as much of that as possible. That's a hard one. And then, you know, you have to memorize a deck of playing cards, which sounds totally impossible. Sounds utterly impossible. But I was able to do it.
And the world record to memorize one is now?
21.9 seconds. Really? Keep in mind, that's somebody who doesn't have, like, any sort of innate skill. He doesn't have a photographic memory. Somebody who trained himself to be able to do that.
Are the photographic memory types, are they considered, like, the cheaters? They're the steroid?
Photographic memory is a myth.
Is it really?
Yeah. It is a myth. There is exactly one case in the scientific literature of somebody with a photographic memory, and most scientists now think it was probably bunk. They actually brought a bunch of memory champions into a lab to have them tested in London a few years back. It's a paper published in Nature. They said, is there something structurally, anatomically different about these people's brains? The answer was no. Is there something, are they smarter? They gave them cognitive tests, IQ tests. The answer was not really. There was one thing that was different about these individuals, and that was when they put them in fMRI scanners and looked at which parts of the brain were lighting up when they were memorizing information, they were seeing different regions. Parts of the brain associated with spatial memory were lighting up. Which sounds strange, but it makes sense, because what they were doing is they were walking around in their imagination in these memory palaces.
So they basically, when they were asked to be thinking about particular numbers or lists, they were actually thinking about their palaces, which is a different part of the brain.
Right. But that's not something that's structurally different about them. That's something that anybody can be trained to do.
All right, well, we'll try that in a separate video here. Joshua Foer, thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me.
And the name of the book is?
Moonwalking with Einstein.
Remember it. This is The Rundown. I'm Hari Sreenivasan. Stay with us.